We begin our look at the current situation with relation to the pandemic in the Niagara region with our acting medical officer of health, Dr. Mustafa Hirji. Dr. Hirji, we've shifted away from the focus being strictly on the number of COVID cases and outbreaks. Is this because we really don't have the resources right now to effectively complete contact tracing?
It's partly about that, but it's almost even more that we don't have the resources to test every person who may have symptoms of COVID-19 or has been exposed to COVID-19 and actually find out who actually has that infection and who doesn't. We've outstripped the number of healthcare providers available to do that testing. And so we've had to limit the number, particularly as our healthcare systems are stressed right now with actually caring for patients infected with COVID-19. And so cases are no longer an accurate representation of what's going on, and we're starting to need to focus on hospitalizations and other metrics where we do have more reliable data.
There has been some confusion over the whole testing process. A lot of people were getting their hands on the rapid antigen test kits over the Christmas break, and now those have been really hard to get in the last few weeks.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this was an error by the province, which I think we were actually highlighting to them in December, that we only have a limited supply of the rapid antigen tests. And with the Omicron wave coming, we would need to make sure we prioritize the tests to where they could do the most good. And I would argue that's making sure our healthcare systems are safe by testing our staff routinely, as well as to keep our schools open by making sure we're using that test to find infections early. Unfortunately, what's happened is we've run out of rapid antigen tests in the province, which is why we're hard to get them now. And the entire world, of course, is dealing with the Omicron wave. You know, our scenario here of very high numbers of infections is the same in many, many countries around the world right now, and everybody is trying to get their hands on rapid antigen tests. And therefore, you know, with all that competition, it's hard to get our hands on them now. And I think we unfortunately didn't use that limited resource we had in the best way possible, and now we're struggling to get supply.
There was a hint of the Omicron variant coming out back in, I think it was early November. Why was the province not prepared enough to deal with this?
Yeah, so I don't think it was a hint in early November about the Omicron wave coming. It was first really identified in that last week of November in South Africa. And it took us maybe a couple of weeks before we really understood what we are dealing with. We had to see what the trends were in South Africa and elsewhere. I think by the second week of December, though, we knew something bad was coming. The Ontario Science Table put out a recommendation that by December 15th, the province needed to put in some really intense measures to limit social contacts in public spaces, to really limit the potential for infections to rise. And I think, unfortunately, the government chose not to go down that road. I think it's best to really ask them why to do it. But I think probably they felt it was politically difficult for them to act when the cases weren't yet high enough and the hospitalizations weren't high yet. And I think that's one of the unfortunate things, is that sometimes we don't get action until we've actually seen the bad thing arrive, which is, of course, too late to then prevent the bad situation from arising.
Of course, now we're hearing about this new variant that is originating in France. Are we likely to see a similar situation?
It does not look like this. So this variant that's emerged in France actually emerged in the middle of November in France. There was kind of a cluster of 12 people who got sick, and then it just sort of fizzled from there and hasn't really been seen in France again. It's popped up a few places around the world. According to the World Health Organization, there's been a few hundred of them around the world at this point over the course of a couple months. But this does not seem to be a variant that has a lot of ability to continue to spread. It just sort of fizzles out wherever it arrives. So it's very different than the Omicron variant.
The Omicron variant is spreading like wildfire. We all know that. And there's a lot of discussion that it just seems everybody is almost destined to contract this variant of the virus. Do you think that is pretty much what the case is going to be? And is it good for someone to contract this milder form of virus?
So absolutely not a good thing to contract this virus. While, you know, people talk about it being mild, I think that's not really the best way of describing it. It is a variant that is less likely to cause hospitalization, less likely to cause death, maybe by a factor of, you know, 25% to 50%. But it absolutely does cause people to be hospitalized. And we're dealing with record high numbers of hospitalizations for COVID-19 in the province. We are absolutely seeing people die from COVID-19 in the province. So I don't think it's advisable to get this infection. I absolutely do think we can prevent the infection. Yes, you know, the numbers are very high. There's a lot of infection going around. We're not going to prevent every single person from getting it, but anything we can do to limit and reduce the number who get sick, I think is a big win. And I think there's absolutely things we can do. You know, if we slow down the virus with some of the social restrictions the provinces put in place, that'll slow it down, buy more time to get booster doses out, which is going to hopefully keep people safe. As well, I think actions we take ourselves in our own personal lives can be really important here. If we go back to what we've done in past waves of infection, where we limit our contacts with other people, we really deprive the infection of the opportunity to spread. If we focus just on interacting with our households for the next little while, keep wearing masks and keeping distance when we're out in public spaces, doing essential things like buying groceries and medicine, et cetera, I think we can keep ourselves safe. We can slow the spread of the infection, get those booster doses and be in a much better place in a couple of months and really avoid a lot of people getting sick.
How do you feel Niagara is doing on the progress of the booster shots?
You know, I think we're doing okay with the progress of booster shots. There's, you know, 350,000 plus people in Niagara who got fully vaccinated. And so we need all of them to get their booster shot while we continue to try and get the first and second doses up to people. We've actually hit a point this week now where we're no longer seeing people unable to get appointments. We actually are having hundreds of appointments added every day and not necessarily seeing all those appointments really being booked up quickly. So I think there's no better time for people to sign up and get that booster dose if they haven't. You'll be probably able to get an appointment the same day or even in the next couple of days if you go online to ontario.ca/bookvaccine.
You've been vocal that it is important to keep schools open. Schools are closed currently. What needs to be done to make sure that, yes, we can open schools, but we can do it safely? Has the province done enough?
Yeah, I think there's definitely more we can do to keep schools open. I think schools are essential. We should be taking a mindset that schools are so important, they should be one of the things that we don't close down. We've managed to keep things like pro sports and film and movie production open throughout waves of infection when we've closed schools. And I just don't think that's right. I think if we can keep those sectors open, we can keep schools open as well. Some of the things that I would do in schools is, of course, really encourage as many people to be vaccinated as possible. That's going to be a first line of defense. I think we should prioritize people associated with the school for testing so we can find infections early, isolate people who have infections, and make sure we limit the spread there. I think when we get rapid tests, we should definitely prioritize sending it to schools and do some regular rapid testing as well. And what I would really like to see is the province put COVID-19 as one of the diseases under the Immunization of School Pupils Act. That will give us in local public health an additional tool to use immunizations to control infections and outbreaks in schools. It works really well with other infections. We rarely see measles outbreaks or the like, thanks to this act, and I think could really help us with preventing COVID-19 outbreaks in schools as well.